Well, this morning's story, I think they did a great job. I hope you could see it reasonably clearly in that small video clip. Visually, I think they picked up the scripture really well and portrayed that well. It's a miracle story above and beyond everything else. But if we sit down and go, well, how could that really have happened? Or was this a strong wind, or did it happen that way, if you start to pull it apart, you'll find you miss the point of the story. It is a miracle story, like many of Jesus' miracles, like so many in the Old Testament. And I don't want you to be sidetracked with those questions just yet. This story is a witness to the power of God, and it's a summons to the people to be people of faith. Fairly much just those two movements, the power of God and the people who would then have faith in that God. Yahweh is very much seen as pulling the strings. He hardens the hearts and he opens the door to go, and he's moving the pillar of cloud this way and that way, preventing the two from getting close to each other. God is very much moving all the pieces on this board, if you like. And all of this is happening in order that God might get glory over Egypt. Over Egypt. So that Egypt will know that Yahweh is God. And that's an interesting thing, really, because when you think about it, this story and the miracle is not so much, not solely directed at the Israelites. It's not just about their freedom. It's not just about their comfort, God coming to rescue them. There's a large element of this story that is for the Egyptians' benefit, that God is doing all of this in this particular way so that Egypt knows that he is God. And that changes things slightly, because the miracle of this story is not just targeting the choir, if you like, the already converted, the people of God, but the miracle is, in no small part, targeting the doubting and cynical world beyond them. God is looking beyond just the people of God to all those around them. And actually, if you continue watching the movie, The Prince of Egypt, what you find is they actually have a few of the Egyptians crossing over with them and running away with them, which I thought was an interesting touch, a nice touch. But this story is a story of God who triumphs not just for the sake of his people, but triumphs over the doubting, cynical world outside. Outside. And that's interesting. That's good for us to have in the back of our mind. And the retelling of this story, as the Jewish people did over and over, year after year, in the celebrating of the Passover and remembering this act of salvation and redemption, and this, what is really the climax of the story, where they are brought from slavery into freedom, as they remember and retell that, is always a call and a summons to faith. So it's both the glory of God and the trust of Israel. And we have them linked directly to the reality of what's going on in the world around them, concrete experiences. It's about the transformation of lives in reality, not just a theory, oh, God is a God of salvation, but God is one who transforms lives from slavery and addictions to freedom and joyfulness and opportunity. So as a story, it's a loud and joyful declaration that Yahweh saves. And as I was thinking about that, it's fairly easy to come up with a summary, because if you look at it, verse 30 is in fact the narrator giving you a summary of what this story is all about. And he says, so Yahweh saved the people. Very simple. That's all it is. But it's great for us to remember that God saves. He is also the God of all creation. You know, over the Egyptians and the Israelites. That's an important part of all creation. And when Moses stretches out his hand and places his staff in the water, and the waters are separated to form dry land, what's going on in the back of your mind? Where else does that happen? Where else are waters separated and divided to form dry land? You remember way back in Genesis when God's Spirit hovers over the water and God separates the waters to form dry land, that there might be a new nation of people, that there might be a new creation in the likeness of God. And here, we very much have God, through Moses, doing the same thing. He's separating the water that a new people might be born, that a new people might begin, really, in God's image. And then when the waters recede and they come crashing back together, then what are you remembering? How in the flood, the waters cleanse and purge and make for a new beginning and wash the old away. With this act, the journey of freedom has begun, well and truly. And it's when we look at our journeys through doors or long pathways, wherever they might start, wherever they might finish, and we look back on a time and we can say, there is no way I could have done that on my own. Yet, here I stand, on the other side. We're linking our lives with this kind of miracle story. It links in all of those times when we say, I didn't think it was possible, yet here I am on this side. Somehow God made a path through. All those times when we say, well, I didn't have the strength to get through this or to get over that, yet somehow God did. That's where our stories link to such an immense story as this one. Maybe they're smaller, maybe the miracles are a little bit less visible and awesome, but it's really the same story, isn't it? When we find ourselves on one side saying, well, I have no idea how I got through from that side to here. That's when we're saying, God saves. God saves in my life. God is still saving in your lives. But if we wind it back a little bit, there is, I think, something powerful when we think of our path going forward. You know, today and tomorrow and the coming week and the coming year. We look at the journey as it stretches out before us, and this passage has so much for us. You know, there's the pillar of cloud where God does show them and literally lights up the path before them. When danger is there, it moves behind them and creates a buffer to keep them safe. But I can't escape that image of the wall of water and the faith and the courage that it would have taken to walk into that. and to step forward. And I know that's a part of my reality. It's not the one that I look for, but I know it's there. And there are plenty of days when you have to say, well, I'll just go a little way, and you sort of are very much inching your way forward. But it is about faith and trust. Those are the things that help us inch forward. When we can say in our hearts, God saves. He has before, so I will step into this daunting channel. I will step into this dark path. One of the things you may not have caught in that little video that I really like, the way that they've put in so many of those nuances of the story as we find it in Scripture, is that as they step in, you'll notice that the way becomes actually fully clear to the other side only just as they get there. You know, what that means is that as they walk in, the end isn't open. You know, isn't that it's an interesting thing to ponder, that they were walking into that channel of water with a wall on their left and to the wall on their right, but the end wasn't all the way through until they kept going and going and going, and it got there and opened up just as they were there, just in time. And how much has God done that in your life? I know he does in mine. I don't see the end when I start the journey. I don't see the conclusion when I begin some of those daunting parts. I don't know for certain. It's faith that get me there. A little bit like Anne's reading, you know, with those architects. They don't have the certainty of finding this or finding that, but what they have is the absence. And they say, in that absence is the room for faith. In the absence of being able to see the journey, of the absence of being able to make it myself with my own steam and my own power, in the absence of those things, there's faith, there's trust that God saves, God redeems, God is the one that makes the way. And lastly, there is a wonderful transformation in this story. That the people of God go from, at the beginning, the fear of Pharaoh. Pharaoh controls their lives. Pharaoh has the power to give or to take or to change their life. And at the end of the story, their fear of Yahweh has replaced that. Not the fear as in, you know, fear and trembling so much, but still a fear that acknowledges God is the one who gives life, who has the power to control life, who has the power to direct life. And in very much the same way they didn't like Pharaoh, who had all that power to control, they now place it into God's hands and willingly accept that control, if you like, that direction of God in their life. We are able to journey in trust and in hope and in faith when we put our lives into God's hands. Even when we don't think it's possible, it's our faith that God can make it possible, that God can transform our fear of the Pharaoh, the disbelieving world around us, the fear of unknown, and transform that into the awesome power of God at work in us. Let's pray. Loving Lord God, creating God, God Almighty, we acknowledge that you are powerful, that you do move mountains, you part waters, you make a way through things in our own lives that we didn't think were possible. when everything got turned upside down and we didn't know that there was a way forward, you've led us here. You've led us to this place through many dangers and snares, through many times of darkness and despair. You've brought us here. And for the journey forward, where we need to be faithful and hopeful and brave beyond our understanding, Lord God, give us faith. Faith in you, the one who creates, the one who redeems, the one who saves.